Good morning. Praise God. God is so awesome and so cool. So cool, so awesome, so cool. Glory. Y'all ever went to sleep and you wake up and you wonder where you're at? You're so tired. Anyway, praise God. Praise God. Things are getting done, though. Things are getting done. Sometimes you can be so, so busy, but nothing get done. Let's go before our Father. We're just talking. Just trying to, you know. Y'all get too serious sometimes. Wow, so serious. And that was the joke was saying to Batman. He said, asking Batman, why so serious? Go around killing everybody. Anyway, Father God, we come to you right now in the name of Jesus. We thank you, Father God, for your love, your grace, your compassion. There is no other God but you. You're an awesome, awesome, awesome King. Father God, we love you. As we go into your word today, Father God, we believe, Holy Spirit, you are unlocking these mysteries, these hidden truths, truths about your word, truths about your love, truths about your wisdom, truths about your compassion for us, truths, Father God. And we believe that we will receive these truths as they are revealed to us today. We will not let slumber. We will not let any kind of distraction to come into our thinking. We want to hear from you, Father God. We love you. And I submit myself to you, Father God, spirit, soul, and body. Use my mind, use my heart, use my mouthpiece to minister your word to your people this day. And we covenant with you right now, Father God, and give you all the praise, all the honor, and all the glory for every victory that will come out of today's session. We thank you, Father God, in Jesus' name. Amen. Turn your Bible to the book of Romans. Romans chapter 10. And I'm going to ask you a question. I'm going to ask you all a question out there. I guess you can say, I'm going to be, just for the next couple, about three, four minutes. Going to be talking to you like an evangelist. You know, there are so many other religions out there. So many other religions. So many of them. And if you go look at them to any degree and you hear their basic message, their basic message is either dying for that God, you got to die for that God, or you accept that God to change your moral behavior. Please hear me. We're gonna come busting right up out the gate like right now. If you have to be respectful to other people's beliefs, but you never have to accept other people's beliefs. Why do you gotta respect other people's beliefs? Because you're respecting the person, not the belief. Come on, I'll say that. You're respecting the person. If they want to serve Buddha, I'm sorry, they're in trouble. They going to hell. If they want to serve Muhammad, I'm sorry. They're in trouble. They going to hell.
Who are you to say something like that?
Well, look what it says in Romans chapter 10. Look what it says in Romans chapter 10. Everybody there? Look what it says. verse 7. No, I'm not that person. Go up. Verse 5. Verse 4.
Okay.
For Christ is the end of the law, for righteousness to everyone that believeth. Righteous. For righteousness is what? For righteousness is what? To everyone. That goes right back to John chapter 3, 16. John chapter 3, verse 16. For God so loved the world. Everyone. 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 Righteousness has been made available for everyone. Everyone how? For Christ is the end of the law. Christ, the end of the law. You know, where you have to die for a God, or you have to receive that God to change your moral behavior. Christ, this Christ, if you look at it, every time you look at the word Christ, it is referring to the body of Christ, except for that Christ. It's specifically referring to Jesus the Christ. Because before anybody gets born again, before anybody had even gotten born again at that time, Jesus was the only representation of the body of Christ at that time. And Paul, this is the point where he's coming from. He said, Jesus the Christ, he is the representation of anybody who believes in him, and you can have righteousness without having to die for any other God, without having to receive any other God, without having to go through any kind of religious practices. Every so often, a Catholic preacher will get my attention, every so often. And they believe in Jesus Christ just like I do. And then he went all off left field somewhere, and he started talking about, you know, we can have righteousness through the mother of Jesus Christ. I'm thinking in my head like, Mary didn't die for me. So, okay. Yeah, after that, we just had to cut him off. But where am I going with that? If you look at a lot of traditional worship services, especially as far as being a Catholic, or even in the Pentecostal, or in the Baptist, they say, you got to do it this way. You got to do it this way. And they almost like shun anybody else who want to worship God in a specific way. And if you look at their religious ceremonies, if you look at them, how they worship God, you find that very same blueprint under the old covenant of the law. And I said, you know, if you really, really study it, you have to study it and look at it, and you go into scripture. If you don't know scripture, don't just look at it and try to judge it, because if you don't know what the Old Testament says, you'll start trying to judge it, and then when you start trying to judge it, based on what your beliefs is, now you way out of the picture. And so you can't do that. So what they're doing, it is ordained of God, but under the old covenant. What does this got to do with anything? Read. Look what it just said, verse 4. For Christ is the end of the law. Jesus put an end to all that. Jesus even said himself, not one jot or one tittle of the law shall pass away till all be fulfilled. Jesus came and fulfilled the requirements of the law. So now when you get to verse 5, it says, for Moses describeth the righteousness which is of the law, that the man which doeth those things shall live by them. Notice it said doeth. Moses came and he described, he said, okay, if you do, God came, Paul said it early in the book of Romans, then Romans chapter 4, it says, that when Moses instituted the law, it was based on a man who was carnal, I mean God who was spiritual, given a perfect law, and then he given it to a man who's carnal or in a fallen state. He had not been redeemed yet. Spiritual, carnal, or fleshly, or humanistic, or humans, or however you want to say it. Spiritual, some perfect. Carnal, some imperfect. Imperfection would never be able to meet perfection. Never, 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 another, no given circumstances. None. And if you go to certain companies, if you work for certain companies and you dealing with certain people, it's almost like they expect perfection out of their employees. You'll never get it. That's why, I love sports, because in sports, you can talk, you can deal with it. How we say it? You're going to have your Peyton Mannings, you're going to have your Tom Brady's, but you're also going to have your Tim Tebow's. You're also going to have your Matt Forte's. Matt Forte is an awesome running back, but he's not Walter Payton. You feel me? Everybody's skill levels are going to be different. Everybody's skill levels are going to be different. So why are you expecting perfection out of everybody? God understands that too. God knows exactly what he put on the inside of you. He knows who you are. The Bible says, when in the Old Testament, he said that God said, I've numbered the very hairs on your head. He knows you. He knows you inside and out. Why you came from him. So now, he says, hey man, God is given the law. And he knows that man can't never meet it. But God had to do that only because God was trying to get his love on them. Oh Lord Jesus. God says, if you do this, then I can bless you. If you do this, then I can bless you. But Jesus came and he put in all that. Yeah. Look at verse 6. But the righteousness which is of faith speaketh on this wise. Say not in thine heart, who shall ascend and head to heaven? That is to bring Christ down from above, or who shall descend into the deep? That is to bring Christ up, Christ again from the dead. Watch this. It's referring to, I used to wonder what the word is, these two scriptures he's referring to, but it's referring to the Old Testament, or it's referring to all other different kind of religious aspects. Notice what I said, or the question I asked you. Most religions is all based on you accepting some God and then you obeying them to receive from them, or you dying for them in the name of that God. But none of them. If I can't say it good enough. Notice I said in my best Ebonics, good enough. None of them says that I'll cover your sins. None of them says I'll die for you. None of them says that I love you so much to where I'll give my only begotten son to die for you. None of them. Look what it says. But, verse 6, but the righteousness which is of faith speaketh on this wise. Say not in thine heart, who shall ascend into heaven, that is to bring Christ down from above. That's religion in itself. You coming up with your own ideas, your own philosophies, your old set way of doing things, and you going to heaven and trying to bring Christ down to you. Or if your God is beneath the earth, you going into the innermost parts of the earth. And do we need to discuss when the innermost part? Well, what is going here? Say, people say they said for years that Satan's, the hell was Satan's kingdom. No, it's not. God created hell. Satan does not have a throne in hell and say, oh yeah, put him over here in this part of the fire. Oh yeah, yeah, destroy them over there, you know, torment them over there for 1,000 years. You know, Satan is not directing traffic in hell. Hell is one big place of torment. And it ain't no such thing as, you know, different compartments where the fire is a little bit less degrees over here than it is over there. It's not. It's just one big place of torment. And Jesus said hell was created for Lucifer and the fallen angels. That lets me know that people were never intended to go there. And the only reason why they went there, is because they were in a fallen state, because of what Adam did to put all of us in jeopardy. But Jesus, what did it say in verse 4? But Christ is the end of that law, to where man doesn't have righteousness, man doesn't have any kind of salvation, man doesn't have any kind of health, wealth, or prosperity, or longevity of life. Jesus came and put an end to all that. That's part of his finished works. But what does it say? Verse 8. But what saith it? The word is near thee, even in thy mouth. What word? And in thy heart, that is the word of faith, which we preach. That's what I'm preaching to you right now. I just said a second ago, I'm going to be talking to you all about like an evangelist type thing. An evangelist type way. Over the next couple of weeks, I'm going to, you know, in the book of Ephesians, it talks about how Jesus came, he gave prophets, apostles, pastors, evangelists, and teachers. And I'm going to be, you know, kind of briefly teaching on the different aspects of each one of those. And the word evangelize, it means to spread abroad. If you look, and we're going to get into deeper meanings of it here over the next couple of weeks. But I'm coming to you as an evangelist right now, just coming straight down the pipe with you. That's why it seems like I'm just busting up all these other religions and all these other traditional ceremonies and all this other stuff. Sometimes you just gotta come straight forward and just hit people in the mouth and then apologize later. And I don't mean actually physically hit somebody, but I'm talking about, you know, it's a big culture shock when you first start hearing that all those other religions, that they're false. God never classified only a few in different storylines. Up under the Old Covenant, where you go and you read with Moses, where you read Dagon, they had their God, but then the Philistines, they had their God. If you go read through our different other aspects of the Bible, under the Old Covenant, they might name one or two of the other gods, but at the end of the day, God called them all idols. He called them idols. Muhammad, he was a real man who walked the earth. He was, but he wasn't a god. Now, even in the midst of like Dragon Ball Z, you know, Battle of the Gods, the movie, and it even shows they're trying to create these other gods for Goku to fight, because Goku to beat everybody else up already. So let's go out and create a god, and let's see if Goku can reach God status. Only through Jesus Christ will Goku ever be able to reach God status. But anyway, I'm just I got a little serious. Why so serious? Let's get back over here. But look what he says. What saith that the word is near thee, even in thy mouth? About to get ready and teach on. I've been teaching on already. Don't think you're going to say. you already know it. And for you all who've read these scriptures before, you're like, I know what point they're going to. Look what it says in verse 9. This is the word that's near thee, even in your mouth, and it's the very word that I'm preaching. That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Jesus is Lord. Jesus saved me. Jesus sanctified me. Jesus made me righteous. Jesus made me holy. Jesus delivered me. Jesus got me in a great marriage. Jesus got me with some great children, even when they ain't acting so great. Jesus got me prosperous. Jesus. Not just God, because every time you say God nowadays, the word Allah, it means God. So if you say Allah to a Muslim, from their perspective, only thing that they're thinking about is what the Quran has to say about Allah or about God. I'm going to say it again. The word Allah, it means, guess what? God. If you was to go look up the word God under the Old Testament, it says God, but most of the time you'll pick up the word Jehovah. You'll bump into that word, Jehovah. Well, guess what that word Jehovah also means? It also means Allah. So now we see this Muslim religion, all they did was adopt the word God and they connected it to some false cult. I said it. But Jesus is God in the flesh. Jesus. Read it again. See, and now I'm gonna, if I gotta say Jesus 1,800 more times for you to finally figure it out. That's why when I'm talking to different people, I always say Jesus. It's like a big, it used to be a big time that I would say God, and then I say, no, Jesus. Jesus. And it's like the Spirit of God saying, oh, say Jesus. Say Jesus. The Bible even says that Jesus has a name that's above all names. Above all names. Jesus. What did Jesus do? That if I confess, the word confess means to not just say with your mouth, because anybody, you know, people just say stuff all the time and don't mean a word. What was the old song you sang? Talking loud and saying nothing. You know, some of y'all are like, I ain't never heard that song. Look it up. It's one of the old songs. Talk loud, ain't saying nothing. They don't believe. Some people know what's the name of that song? Oh, Lord Jesus, what's the name of that song? He said, I believe every lie that I ever told. He believed every lie he ever told. Cool song, really, really cool song, funny song. Man, I'm the man. Yes, I am. I'm the man. I buy man's shoes. Don't mess with me. I'm a pimp. But when you confess this, it is not just a profound belief, not just something that from your standpoint. It's not just something from your standpoint, that your own personal opinion. When you confess this, the word confession, it means a broad statement that's based on truth. I'm gonna say it again. It is a broad statement. It covers so many different aspects that's based on truth. And for all of y'all in here, they may not know it out there, but all of y'all in here, y'all know the difference between truth and facts. Facts can be changed, but truths cannot. Like, I don't care what men and women are doing to their bodies. I don't care if Satan got in their head and said, well, you a man trapped in a woman's body, or you a woman trapped in a man's body. You can't change your DNA. This is not Jurassic World or Jurassic Park, where they manipulate DNA to try to create some other animals. You cannot change your DNA. You cannot change your DNA. Even in the midst of cloning. They're using the DNA of other animals to create different animals. DNA of a cat, how they gonna get another cat? They use the DNA of another cat. And guess what it's gonna create? A cat. You even find that, you find that very same principle in Genesis. What it say? The seed of every kind is in itself. Is in itself. So when, just like, if you were to take my seed, if you never saw me before, and you were to take my seed, and you were to go put it in the test tube, it's gonna create a human. It ain't gonna create no monkey or no gorilla. So if I confess with thy mouth or my mouth, the Lord Jesus, what does the word Lord mean? Boss, Messiah. In the book of Genesis, Big John, it says, by him were all things created, and without him there was nothing that was created. Jesus created it all. He's Lord of it. He's Lord of it. So I'm going to confess Jesus is being Lord, and I'm going to believe in my heart that God raised him from the dead. God? How God going to raise somebody from dead? He God. God exemplified his resurrecting power in the book of Genesis. And God breathed into Adam the breath of life. Adam was dead. He was sculptured and molded out of some dirt and hit his dirt ears. And God said, live! And Adam got up and said, hey, God, how you doing? What's up? He lived. So God did the same thing to Jesus. Jesus died. Bible even says that God promised Jesus that his body would not see corruption. And they say after about 2 or 3 days, under normal circumstances, that a body begins to decay after about 3 days. It really, really begins to decay. That's why if you harvest different parts of the body and you try to do implants or whatever, transplants to other people's lives, whatever, hearts and lungs, they say after you get this heart, if somebody need a heart transplant, the heart is valuable. It's usable. Let me just say it like that. It's usable with an X number of hours even after the person is deceased. But they have to act quickly, because if they don't, their organ begins to decay. Well, that's the way it was with Jesus. Jesus decayed, his body died. He physically died. He didn't go into a slick coma. what historians try to make it seem to be. He didn't give any kind of medicine to where, you know what they say, you see it, what's these different movies now? Well, you can free somebody so much so, like Captain America, he was froze for 70 years and his body just stayed alive. and after he thawed out, he woke up. It ain't none of that. Jesus, graveyard dead, his spirit man left his physical body. Completely separated from the physical body. And he went into hell. He didn't go to heaven first. He went into hell to preach who he was to all of those people under the old covenant who died. Oh, glory to God. And when I do that, what it said in verse 10, at the end of verse 9, I mean, raise him from the dead, thou shalt be what?
Saved.
I'll be saved. That word saved means sozo. That word, it is God's unmerited favor. It's another way of saying grace. It's God's love and compassion trying to run you down. And what did you just do? You bypass any religious ceremony. You bypass any kind of law that you ever have to obey. All you did was believe on Jesus being Lord. And you confess that with your mouth. It completely wipes out all these other aspects of any kind of religion, any kind of idol. Jesus, 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 Jesus. There's nobody else. There's nobody else. Somebody asked me, what is it that keeps you driving, just keeps you pushing? Jesus. It's like, I was watching a football induction ceremony last night on NFL Network, and Brett Favre was on there. He said, and I love the way he said it, and when you out there, and I'm talking to a lot of younger folks, anyone of you old people now, don't cheat other people around you. Don't cheat other people around you. Why? By not going out there and giving it your all. Jesus made sure he didn't cheat nobody. For God so loved the world that he says, I don't want not one person, even the people who died before I sent Jesus, to say that I didn't give them an opportunity. Every person on this planet, every person on this planet, at some point in time, will hear that Jesus is the Christ. Period. God don't want to leave. Think about it. If one person doesn't hear, God showed that with Abraham. Abraham, if you can find 50 people in Sodom and Gomorrah, I want to destroy. You're talking about thousands of people. Thousands. God just said 50. And then Abraham walked them down. What about 40? What about 30? What about 20? What about 10? God said it wasn't even 10 righteous people in the whole, from two cities together. Wasn't even 10. It was 8. If Abraham would have kept going, God would have never destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. If Abraham would have just went on down to 1, which Lot and his wife was righteous because they obeyed. They followed God, same way Abraham did. But God said, he was just sitting up there waiting. Well, Abraham never said anything else. God says, I am not going to stand here, me being God, I'm not going to even give anybody an opportunity to say, hey, you never gave me a chance to receive Jesus. So God's going to make sure. Even when some of you weak Christians around now, you scared to tell people that you born again, you scared to tell people that Jesus is the Christ, God gonna have to send, even if you ain't standing up bold enough, God is gonna have to send somebody else to this person in front of you to make sure that they tell them about Jesus. If you being weak, why? Because God is not gonna, he's gonna give everybody the same opportunity to receive Jesus Christ as their Lord. I mean, you'll be turned down, but you can't take it personally because Jesus died for them too, just like he died for you. I mean, I have talked to people, and I'll say, And you know, you be all fun and games, and you pull people aside, and you get serious, and you say, okay, hey man, hey young lady, I'm giving you an opportunity right now. And that's the opportunity I'm giving you all right now. I'm asking you a question. If you died today, where would you go? Where would you go? God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that if you believe in him and you confess him as your Lord, you bypass any kind of religious aspect, you bypass any kind of denomination, you bypass any kind of occult or any kind of set rules. All you have to do is confess Jesus Christ as your Lord. And when you do that, God will supernaturally give you the drive to go after God even more. You'll begin to see all those things that you have trouble with, they'll just drop off. It'll be a challenge on the front end. Don't get me wrong. Looked at my hands and they look new. Looked at my feet and they did too. No, man, no, you're gonna have the same old rusty hands. And then you start trying to clean them up a little bit. You're gonna still have the same old big 13 feet ivory. And guess what? But you, God's gonna be just, before you know, you're gonna be pressing into God, you're gonna be stubborn, you're gonna learn how to pray, and the Spirit of God gonna be in you, auctioning you to do certain things, and before you know it, you're gonna be like, I don't wanna do this stuff no more. It's just gonna fall off. It's gonna become almost disinteresting to you. And that's gonna be the power of God. And then guess what? When you die, you're gonna be with him. Glory to God. If the rapture takes place day after tomorrow, you're going to go. Let's finish this up. Look what it says. For the scripture saith, verse 10. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Look what it says. With the heart man, or mankind, or any man, believeth how? Unto righteousness. Right. Notice, you didn't have to go out and try to stop smoking, stop cussing, stop committing adultery. At some point in time, because of the righteousness of God in you, and you pressing into God, those things will just drop off. You'll stop lying. You'll stop wanting to talk about folk as you press into God. And guess what? You're going to be like, man, God, I love you. Why? Because that's grace. That's grace. He loves you. He loves you. Man, oh Lord Jesus. God, Jesus. I am so glad God gave his son for me. Now, I am standing before you righteous. Notice what it said. I've asked the question. If you died today, where would you go? Don't come and say I was raised in the church. No, don't go religious on me. I was raised in the church. I heard that stuff before. You know, I don't go to church because people talk about, I ain't talking about you going to church. I'm talking about right now, you believe it and confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord. I'm presenting to you the best I can right now and articulating the best I can that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. If you've never accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord, and you all in here, I want you to raise your hand. And you all out there, we're going to say this prayer. We're going to say this prayer. And I want you to be able, I want you to confess Jesus Christ as your Lord right now. And you become my brother and my sister. So here we go. I see some of y'all's hands out there. I see your hands out there. Just say, okay. Just repeat after me. Say, God. Everybody in the room. Everybody in the room. Say, God. I come to you right now. That's two people. All these folks in here. Come on now. God, I come to you right now. In the name of Jesus, I believe in my heart and I'm confessing with my mouth that Jesus, that you, Father God, raised Jesus from the dead for me. I believe that he died, rose from the dead to pay the penalty for my sins. I thank you for raising him from the dead. If you prayed that prayer just now, Bible says you got born again. Jesus said you got born again by the Holy Spirit. You are now my brother and my sister in Christ Jesus. All is well in the kingdom. All is well in the kingdom. If you did that, write me, email me, post it on Facebook and let me know. Say, Pastor, I prayed that prayer with you, and I believe that I confess Jesus Christ is my Lord, and Jesus is my Lord, and I am saved from this day forward. And I'll send you some good things in the mail. Praise be to God, because Jesus, he died for the world. He didn't just die for Christians. He didn't just die for Catholics. He didn't just die for Baptists. He didn't just die for Presbyterians. He died for the world. And I'll be glad when evangelists and other preachers tell that to folk. Jesus didn't come just to die and be crucified and manipulated and spit on just so that he can die and manipulate for a small group of people. He died for the world. Hey, email me. Let me know. Let me know. Tell me your testimony. I want to hear it. I want to hear it. Why? Because Jesus is the Christ. Jesus, and you, as you walk with them, you'll begin to see that these other things, they're going to just drop off. They're going to just drop off. That bad attitude that you used to have, it's just going to drop off. And soon, before you know it, other people are going to look at you, because they're going to know that old you, and they're going to be like, man, Ivory, you changed. Jesus, that's your opportunity right now. Jesus is the one who did it. Jesus is the one. Ivory in itself couldn't do anything. You see all the different self-help books on TV and people telling, they say, I've made a decision that I've made. No, Jesus. Jesus helped me. Jesus is the one who gave me life. Jesus is the one who showed me how to take care of my wife. Jesus is the one who showed me how to love my children. Jesus is the one who delivered me from sex and drugs and alcohol. Jesus is the one I can actually be intimate with my wife and not be perverted. Glory to God, man! Jesus, Jesus, Jesus! Jesus, Jesus is the one who's gonna prosper. Man, we gonna make Jesus the high note all the time. Just say Jesus. If it wasn't for Jesus, you see these little bumper stickers, man? And it said, Jesus is the answer. Bless the name of Jesus, A-Rod. You ain't got to put none of that. No, Kojic.com and all. No, Jesus is the answer. Nothing said. Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Jesus. Man, Jesus. So, hey, you born again. I'm born again. We may not meet each other here in the earth, but we will meet each other one day when Jesus come get us on the body here. And I'm going to be like, praise be to God. You going to come tell me, Pastor, I saw you on YouTube. I saw you on Facebook. And I received Jesus Christ as my Lord. I was too ashamed to tell you and email it to you. But, you know, I began to live this life. And I just didn't like to do all that social network stuff. But I saw it. And I got born again. And praise be to God, because you told me about Jesus. Bless the name of God. I'm born again, and I'm standing here in glory with you. And I'm going to be like, praise God, Jesus, because he's the only reason why you're able to see him. Now, I still remember, and I'm going to close it up here. I'm just talking, just excited now, man. That woman, that black, tall black woman, she said, if you don't get saved, you know you're going to hell. And guess what I did? I don't want to go to hell. Man, I took off up there, and Jesus came into my life, man. Glory Gator, I don't know where you are at, but guess what? Thank you for telling me about Jesus. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Man, that's good, man. Hey, we'll be right back.